Challenge, I said, after all, Eliu has told me the spirit of the Lord gives inspiration. In Isaiah chapter 61, where the spirit of the Lord is upon you, everything will just flow. In Ezekiel, it says, eat the word. So I knew very well the work is to start with me, to eat the word, to prepare myself to eat the word. So I'll be able to go out and give the same as much as I have received. Now, the mission of the ministry. Edify the body of Christ until we come to the fullness of Christ to do the work of the ministry. That's why we have the apostles, we have the prophets, we have the evangelists, we have the teachers, we have the pastors, the fivefold ministry. All of them, they have one single job, is to edify the body of Christ. And that's where now God gave me that mission to the church. I edify the body of Christ and teach people the way Jesus had a mission with his disciples. He trained them 3.5 years. He'll test them and tell them, go out. They'll go out and preach and bring the result, the feedback. So, the mission is to edify the body of Christ worldwide. Not just within a local, whatever, but on a broad anchor. Now, the goal is to replicate and inherit the kingdom of God. At the end of the day, after doing the work, there's something that Paul said in the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter number 9. He is compelled to discipline himself to do the gospel so that he should not wait to give others and then to take security into it. But he's pressing that after preaching the gospel, he must enter into it. That's why even I, it's my great hope. But after doing my work, level, as the Lord has moved out, there is a ministry that he has been shifting from one level to the other. That's to say, when you become to perfect the ministry of perfect the body of Christ, there are things you have to grow up. And that grow, you become a trainer or you become a model. That's not what the Bible says, that iron sharpens iron. That's how a friend changes or sharpens the face of another brother. And that's what the ministry comes to be. It's very effective so that you can do the work of God in a very effective way. Why is it that the ministry is not effective? There are a few things that we have never done. And you want just to share some small about it and the
Thank you. Bible tells us that we must be born again to enter into the kingdom. I am born again to enter into the kingdom. The Lord has been with me, has walked with me, has brought me this far. He indeed is my evidence. The men of Israel rushed out of Mizpah,
Now, just what you have shared about salvation, it's all about the Lord of the Spirit. For we don't war against the blood and the flesh. For our spiritual warfare is mighty, pulling down the strongholds, the principalities. Now, what do we need? We just need the Holy Spirit. And because of that, we need to understand, when you are born again, who are you in the kingdom? Let us see the way you have said in the book of Romans, chapter number 8. That's our main reading. Come from there. For the Bible says there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Why? Because Jesus paid the whole ransom. Everything. So nobody can say, you know, today you are like this, the other you are like that. No, it's not condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So I would like you to read from verses 1 to verses. Yes.
Verse 1, Romans. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of His life has set you free from the law of sin and death.
Yes.
For what the law was powerless to do because it was weaker by the flesh, God did by sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so He condemned sinful flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us, who did not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the flesh have the answer to what the flesh desires. And those who live according to the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is testimony. It does not submit to God's will. Those who are in the realm of the flesh, you, however, Spirit of God is in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit is right because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of God raised Jesus from the dead, is given to you. He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to the dead. Because of the Spirit of his life. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have a but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if the Spirit will put you to death, then it is not to live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God.
Amen. For as many are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Now, when we look at these facts, the Bible says, to be carnally minded is dead. Because the carnal mind cannot understand the spiritual. Because spiritual things are spiritual inside. There are things that you can look at with your natural eyes and you don't understand. Until you get the spiritual side of it. And that's what Paul reminded the brethren, that when we walk in the flesh, we are walking according to the law. According to the law means what? You observe the law. When you observe the law, it means you don't do this and you don't do that. But when you're in the spirit works in you. It changes the character, the quality, everything. The spirit works like water. When you're thirsty, you take the water. You don't tell the one to start from here. No, the work of the world as it enters you, it knows exactly where you are. Now, when you are born again, you are a child of God. You have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You now need to walk in the Spirit. Now, when you walk in the Spirit, the same scripture in the Bible says that the Spirit comes from you. To be born again is different, and to walk in the Spirit. We have to grow. Now, when you are growing, the Spirit will understand your flesh. And then the Spirit will start modifying those weaknesses. It will be removing this belief that you are angry. You know, all the time you are angry. The Spirit of the Lord says, oh, this lady or this brother, I have come in this. So you have to keep your spirit and patience. So you not to be just angry with anything. You can control yourself. Why? Because the Spirit is leading you to the right way. And then here, the Bible is categorical. Those who have Christ, they belong. And those who doesn't have Christ, they don't. That's why you have this. People say, out of all men, do good. I help the poor, I give this and this. Good! Those are good people. You're doing good. That's good. You're giving whatever. But the question is Christ dwelling in you? The genesis of your righteousness must be Jesus. Anything you do outside Christ is just not sin. Because you're pleasing yourself. Young people, I don't like you, you know, I'm doing this so that people can see you. You say, but when you're in Christ, you'll not be doing it to yourself, but you'll be doing it to God. Always, you'll be saying, this thing it has been done to glorify the name of the Lord. Now let us see, if we are the children of God, what do we gain? You know, when you are a child, most people say, after all, I'm born again, I'm a child. What's the benefit to be a child? Same chapter, Romans chapter 8. Can you read verses 15 to 18?
The spirit you received does not make you slaves, so that you live in fear again. Rather, the spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his suffering, in order that we may also share in his.
Amen. You see, when you have the Spirit of God, you are liberated. You don't live under God. Now the question is this. telling me, man of God, you're telling me I'm not living under bondage. And why am I having problems? Jesus, remember himself, he had sufferings, but he had nothing. Why? He came to liberate man. When you suffer with Christ, the same Christ, you'll glory with him. So it is without suffering in Christ Jesus. There's no glory. Where will the glory come from? How can you be given a crown without doing anything? You see? And because we are co-heirs with Christ, that's why the devil cannot sleep. He's fighting you. He's fighting me. Whatever you want to do, the devil will come and tell you, don't pray. Don't do this. Don't do that. What? The devil, the work of the devil is just to discourage you so that you are defeated. But when you realize you are given the spirit of adoption, you are a son, you are a daughter, you are a child of God, you are entitled to the heavenly blessings, you can say, Abba Father, here I am. And the Spirit of God responds. And Jesus says, he is, she is my comfort. And that's why when we are spirit filled, we can do exactly, cast out demons, we pray for the sick, they are healed, we speak, and we come. Why? Because we are connected to the Spirit of God. That's Jesus. Now we can see this scripture coming into reality. As a son, you've been given the Spirit of adoption. You're no longer just a man, just a floor. The heavens are watching over you. The angels are watching over you. All the time, they are communicating. They have a destiny. So even if you suffer in Christianity, you rather suffer in Christ Jesus than to suffer outside Jesus. Because if you suffer outside Jesus, you'll never be converted. But when you suffer in Christ Jesus, this is a conversation. Why? Come back and say, restore whatever the devil has stolen from the child. Job suffered in God, not outside God. And when the time of restoration came, he was going to die. But the question is, if we'd have suffered outside God, where would have restoration come? Our distance. And all. Sometimes when you are suffering, it's not the devil. You are being tested that you are faith like God. When God wants to lose you, there are things you must lose first. These are times when they Jesus would lose his own life in order to and say, I have to. Even remember when he was praying, the prayer was to pray. The Bible says that instead of sweat, the blood. And he may say, God, if it is you, let me take this cup. He was saying, it's not my will. This cup pass. But come you. Come to me. Come to me. You're not sufficient without that cross. So there's some suffering that God has for us. But in order to make this. When you come, that's not the same. If it was not for me, I would not be the way. Now, come to verse 20. When you come to prayer, when you are the children of God, you know sometimes we talk about prayer. Pastor, you don't know how to pray. Just teach me how to pray. Read that verse.
Verse 20 says, God, in the same way, the Spirit helps us in our prayers. We do not know what we ought to pray. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us through our words and prayers. And he who searches our hearts knows that.
Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our infirmities. For we do not know what we should pray as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searches the hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. We cannot understand the will of God unless we do so. And that's sometimes when even God does things with our own kind of mind, we start analyzing. No, you know, God would have done this, we don't have that. And this one finds me, you never understand sometimes a man of the Spirit. Just the way you see the world, you don't know if God. That's why even sometimes a man of God just give the words that you never understand. Why? Because all the spirit of God, which such a man loves me. We can pray many, many things,
yes.
But the question is, you know, sometimes we pray according to what we want, not what we need. So God will look at your prayer, you pray, there's no answer. The question is the Spirit of God involved? And that's why every born again needs the Spirit. For this Spirit of God will reveal the mind of God at a particular hour and a particular moment. Maybe God wants you to pray about other people, but you are praying for yourself. You are praying selfish. And God wants you to pray for someone from very far. And maybe when you pray for that person, God will go and touch that person. God will go and bless that person. And then that prayer of that person will come out. So God works in a mysterious way. If you look at the example, when Peter was praying in the house of Simon at Joppa, he just went up upstairs to pray. The same Cornelius, he was praying there. And the prayers of Cornelius and the prayers of Peter got united. The Spirit of God united them. So when we pray according to the will and the mind, you will find that our prayers have been answered. Why? Because God Himself has touched those prayers. God Himself has spoken over the prayers, and you are praying according to the will of God. That's now we need to embrace the Spirit of God. Not in our carnal minds, not the way we think, not the way we plan. Yes, plan is not bad. But the question is it according to the will of God? Or according to our carnal mind? And sometimes when we do things into carnality, you find that we are being hurted, you know, because the flesh, the Bible says, the blood and the flesh will never inherit the kingdom of God. It will remain here, but only the Spirit that will inherit the kingdom of God. Which means, when we are born again, we are the children of God. There's no condemnation for those who believe in Christ Jesus, for those who walk in Christ Jesus. You know, when you start walking in Christ Jesus, sometimes you walk contrary to the will of people. You walk contrary. Because people, you know when you are in a group of people, there are things, you call them like norms, okay? As a group, you say you agree this and you agree that. But now Christ says you don't agree. Why are you not doing the way we are doing? Now you find that there will be separation as time goes on. But the better separation, than to stay with them, and then you don't inherit the kingdom of God. Because salvation, after all, is about intimacy. We come to help each other, we come to strengthen each other, you see, to fortify each other. But in really sense, salvation is all about that. So when you ask for the Spirit of God to indwell in you, that Spirit of God will make you to be strong and you walk. Until you come at our guest and say, let us see this one. It says, even if you go through the tribulations, can you read for us that for
me? Who then is the one? No one. Christ Jesus died, more than that, who was raised to life. He is at the right hand of God and is also in his seat. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? For your sake, we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. Knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, neither height, depth, or any else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God.
This nothing can separate us from the love of God. So long as you accept Christ as your Lord and your personal Savior, nobody can condemn you. The demons have no power. devil has no power. Even the pastors that work because they never die for you. So when you are in Christ Jesus, there's nothing can separate you. No tribulation, persecution, famine, sword, when you are in Christ Jesus, you are adopted as a child of God. And when you are adopted as a child of God, you don't become a child. Just like a man when you give birth to a child. He or she's your child. Whether you go away, where you just remember this child belongs to Sister Molly. Whether they know more. So when you have been rejected, genetic, your spirit has been connected into the kingdom of God. You belong to God and you are not in your child. What do you mean? Even if you have a child, your child is a child. That child can open anything. Use that child. So even in the kingdom of God, we need the spirit of God that will work us through. And when God makes us through, we shall look to the Lord. That's now we can go to the book of Revelation, chapter number 5, number 4. Ephesians chapter number 4.
Whatever you do,
whatever you do,
do it all in the name of the Lord.
Amen. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and the spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father. Exactly what we are doing here. We are admonishing one another, teaching one another, until we become rich in the word of Christ. And then when you come rich in the word of Christ, we are able to have the mind of Christ. Because Christ is our mind. And when you have the mind, it's that the Spirit of God is one. And this one you can remember in the book of John 14, where it says that if you have my word, and if you keep my word, I and my Father shall come and dwell in you, and shall manifest God. So when you have the word, the Spirit of God will be closer to you. The Spirit of God will manifest to you. And if you don't have the word to say, me, I'm a Christian, I'm a Christian. Yes, sing Christianity from the mouth, but in the heart, so here even the devil comes, but it's my prayer that we need to have the word of God so that we can grow to the fullness stature of our life. And if we grow to that level, let me tell you, the kingdom of God, the kingdom of the devil will never be against the kingdom. So the challenge is not outside the challenges that you will need to do until the rest of your past. So let us start. God bless you as we continue. Our dear listeners, we want to thank you and we want to bless you for this just session we have. That is Christ Jesus. Yes, the service, the vanity experience. God wants people to go out and work. If you don't have the word, you don't have the word. Yes. It's my prayer. God will see us with this passion. And God will bless us. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we want to thank you. We want to bless you for the assurance of our salvation. That is not your mission. Lord, we want to thank you and we want to bless you. We want to confess our belief in Christ Jesus. That we call you to be the sons of God. My Father, we call you because of your sake. And the Spirit tells us that even if you are in all things, this Spirit such as the mind of God, this Spirit such as our mind, and it is exactly the same. I thank you and bless you, Lord, for what sense? Who can condemn us? Nobody can condemn us because only Christ who died for us. Father, we want to thank you for this. So we say nothing is impossible. Even though Father, because of his missions, you go through sufferings and all those kinds of people, things, my Father, nothing will separate us. Lord, we want to acknowledge you as our Lord and our Savior. And Lord, we want to pray and give us strength so that we can continue in this journey that you can get. Father, we thank you and bless you. It's in Jesus' name.